Welcome back to the fourth session of the day. On behalf of JLF Colorado, Festival Co-Directors Namita Gokhale and William Dalrymple, Festival Producer Sanjoy K. Roy, and all my colleagues at Team Vakats, Boulder Public Library, and the City of Boulder, we welcome you to this session of JLF Colorado 2021 Virtual Festival. The Roots of a Nation, Fali S. Nariman, introduced by Tripur Daman Singh. Celebrated writer, jurist, and former president of the Bar Association of India, Fali S. Nariman is the author of God Save the Honorable Supreme Court, The State of the Nation, and his recent Constitution of India, among others. He takes us on a reflective journey through the layers, complexities, and nuances of the document that marked the arrival of the world's largest democracy. One of the world's longest and most important political texts, the Constitution of India was adopted by the Republic of India on the 26th of January, 1950, laying the framework of governance, fundamental rights, and civil responsibilities that have formed the very roots of India. Introduced by writer and historian Tripur Daman Singh, in this session, Fali S. Nariman speaks of his life, experience in law, and the Indian Constitution. Fali S. Nariman. Fali S. Nariman has grown up with the Constitution. He started his career in the High Court of Bombay in 1950. Since 1972, when he shifted to New Delhi, he has been continuously practicing in India's Supreme Court, where he has attained eminence. He was nominated as a member of the Rajya Sabha in November 1999, was awarded the Padma Bhushan in 1991, and the Padma Vibhushan in 2007. He is the author of the best-selling Before Memory Fades, an autobiography, and State of the Nation in Context of India's Constitution. Tripur Daman Singh. Tripur Daman Singh is a historian of South Asia and currently the British Academy postdoctoral fellow at the Institute of Commonwealth Studies, University of London. He is the author of two acclaimed books, 16 Stormy Days and Imperial Sovereignty and Local Politics. Do follow our social media handles to get notifications on the upcoming sessions. In these difficult times, we have struggled to bring you JLF Colorado 2021 without charging a registration fee. Please support as generously as you can to ensure a free, seamless, and continuous flow of knowledge. Simply click on the Support JLF option button on the right-hand side of your screen. Your contribution is greatly appreciated. Ladies and gentlemen, The Roots of a Nation, Fali S. Nariman, introduced by Tripur Daman Singh. Over to you, Tripur Daman.
Thank you very much, Reema. And may I start with saying just how much of an honor and a pleasure it is to introduce and share space with Mr. Nariman. It's seldom that one gets an opportunity to introduce and share space with someone who can legitimately be described as a living legend. And Mr. Nariman very much is one and an absolute institution in India's constitutional and jurisprudential history. In many ways, Mr. Nariman's life has mirrored the life of the Indian Republic. As you mentioned, he started practicing in the Bombay High Court in 1950, just months after the Indian Constitution was inaugurated. And since then, as a lawyer, as a legal theorist, as a law officer of the Government of India, as a parliamentarian, as an acclaimed writer, he has had a ringside view at the constitutional life of the Indian Republic. And this includes personal involvement in some of the most significant cases that have shaped the history of Indian jurisprudence, for example, some like I.C. Golaknath and the Bennett Coleman cases would be very, very prominent examples. So there is really no greater authority to take us through this journey about the layers, complexities, and nuances of the Indian Constitution, and indeed of Indian constitutional history. Mr. Nariman has been a close participant, a perceptive observer, and a very faithful chronicler of the lives of the Indian Constitution and indeed of the Indian Republic. So it gives me very great pleasure to introduce him, and it is a very great honor to share space with him. So I'll hand over the screen to Mr. Nariman, if you might like to start your speech.
Thank you, Tripodaman. Good to see you and hear you. My presentation is in three parts. There's the first an introduction, then something about the Constitution, and the conclusion as the third part. First, the introduction. Louis Brandeis, judge and jurist, always used to say that it is only when a nation has lawyers who understand the public interest and the changing needs of society that the country will have judges to provide social as well as legal justice. And to support this statement, he used to tell the following story. At the end of the 19th century, when the nation of Montenegro in the continent of Europe secured its independence, the ruler wanted his country to have a code of laws like other civilized nations. And he requested a great scholar of the law, a man by the name of Bogigis, professor at the University of Odessa, to prepare a code. The professor agreed and he undertook the task, not by relying on law books or his own phenomenal legal knowledge, but he went out to live with the people of Montenegro for 2 years, studying their customs and practices, familiarizing himself with the roots of the nation. He then drafted a constitution for Montenegro, and as Brandeis always used to put it, the people respected it because it expressed the will of the people. This is how Gandhiji wanted India's constitution to be written. But economist Shriman Narayan had already published a book in 1946 titled The Gandhian Constitution for Free India. It had introduced for the first time the complete draft of an indigenous Indian constitution with decentralized legislative, executive, and judicial bodies based on village panchayats. It also laid out a set of fundamental duties to go along with fundamental rights. The Mahatma then endorsed the author's proposal by contributing a foreword to the book. But ladies and gentlemen, this was not the way India's constitution was fashioned, neither in the Brandeis way nor as Shriman Narayan wanted. India's constitution was fashioned in the manner in which all ordinary laws are now made. 296 members of India's Constituent Assembly, a body elected on the basis of a very limited franchise, debated for nearly 3 years a draft constitution, the text of which was prepared by India's constitutional advisor B.N. Rao. Shortly after it was adopted, the Constitution First Amendment Act was steamrolled through India's Provisional Parliament, which was the same as the Constituent Assembly, in June 1951 by a then majoritarian Congress government amidst much opposition. An avowedly liberal constitution had been transformed into a staid, pragmatic one. A book recently published, 16 Stormy Days, contains a fascinating critique of this First Amendment of India's Constitution. Its author, Tripodarman Singh, exposing the perils of having a majoritarian national government at the center. In the Indian subcontinent, one unforgettable lesson about written constitutions has been that they don't work on their own. A special effort has to be made by those entrusted to work them so that they do not collapse and flounder. Pakistan, an independent state, had been brought into existence by Britain's parliament at the same time and in the same manner as independent India. Pakistan had its own constituent assembly, but before that body could produce a written constitution, it was summarily dissolved by Pakistan's Governor General. Then 6 years later, there was pieced together a constitution of the Islamic Republic of Pakistan, 1956, which heralded a parliamentary system of government. And shortly thereafter, that was evaluated by Pakistan's president without his having constitutional authority to do so. As a consequence, Pakistan, unlike India, had to undergo prolonged periods of martial law. When India's Constituent Assembly was about to complete its task of finalizing a constitution, in November 1949, the chairman of its drafting committee, Dr. Ambedkar, addressed its members saying that since the working of a written constitution did not depend solely upon its text, he would refrain from discussing the merits. And he gave as his reason the following: because I feel, however good a constitution may be, it may turn out to be bad, because those who are called upon to work it happen to be a bad lot. And however bad a constitution may be, it may turn out to be a good if those who are called upon to work it happen to be a good lot. I now go to my second part. In this part, I will be speaking about some of the salient features of the Constitution. As you are already told, one of the longest ever framed for an independent country. But strict time constraints preclude a more extensive and exhaustive comment. The Indian Constitution contained 395 articles and 8 schedules, occupying as many as 251 printed pages in the official edition. It was added to and amended now on 105 separate occasions, and yet it remains a highly centralized document. Unity of the nation has been mentioned up front in the preamble, and the very first article described its structure. India, it said, shall be a union of states. Its length was due not merely to the size of the country, but to the problems of accommodating the points of view of representatives of people speaking different languages, observing different faiths, and at the same time striving to transform a rigid hierarchical social order into an egalitarian society. The chapter on fundamental rights, part 3, owed much to the standard-setting charter of the United Nations and the almost contemporaneous Universal Declaration of Human Rights, December 1948. The Constitution was and remains, even after 105 amendments, divided into 22 parts dealing with various aspects of the country's governance. In some places, it suffers from excessive emphasis on detail, which could have been left to ordinary legislation. And it often also displays a hybrid mixture of different, at times conflicting, concepts. For instance, with more than 30 main indigenous languages and dialects from which to choose, the Constitution recognized English as one as of the two official languages. Amongst the 14 regional languages then listed in the 8th schedule was Sanskrit, which, like Latin, is a dead language spoken only in prayer. The preamble to the Constitution by amendment proclaimed India to be a secular republic, and yet the chapter on fundamental rights continued to recognize and protect India's 6 main religions and nearly 200 religious persuasions. The right to equality was guaranteed, Article 14, and the state was prohibited from discriminating against any citizen on grounds of race, religion, caste, or place of birth, and yet the Constitution recognized and encouraged compensatory discrimination in favor of socially and educationally backward classes of citizens. However, economic backwardness arising from dire poverty has not been recognized as a basis of a preferential treatment
in educational institutions or in public employment. Whilst adopting adult suffrage as the basis for periodic elections to parliament and state assemblies, and abolishing the prior special electoral rolls based on race, religion, caste, or sex, the Constitution provided for reservations of seats in the House of the People and in the Legislative Assembly of every state for scheduled castes and scheduled tribes who were and are for centuries outcasts of Hindu society. Such reservation, initially for 10 years, has been extended indefinitely from time to time and remains in force. But despite all these seemingly disparate and contradictory provisions necessitated by social, historical, and political considerations, if there has been one overriding concept discernible in India's constitution, it is a concern for the unity of the nation. The framers in 1950 had undertaken an ambitious and noble enterprise, and their product had pleased nearly everyone. There were a few, however, who were not impressed. A former chief minister of Karnataka, a down-to-earth politician, Mr. K. Hanumanthaya, had been disappointed with the work of the Constituent Assembly. And he had complained, "We wanted the sweet notes of the Veena, but we were given the music of an English band." The parliamentary system of government set up under India's constitution, the music of an English band, as Hanumanthaya irreverently, though quite accurately put it, is based on a clear-cut division of governmental functions: executive, legislative, and judicial, but not in watertight compartments. At the center, the Union Executive consisted and consists of the President of India along with a Vice President who presides over the Council of States, and a Council of Ministers with the Prime Minister at its head to aid and advise the President in the exercise of his functions. There is a similar division of functions in the state. The Union Legislature, that is Parliament, consisted and consists of the President again at the head with two Houses of Parliament, one known as the Council of States, the other the House of the People. The Council of States, the Rajya Sabha, having 238 representatives of states in India elected by the elected members of legislative assemblies of each state, as well as representatives of Union territories that are not fully fledged states, and the House of the People, that's the Lok Sabha, which consists of 525 members chosen by direct election from territorial constituencies in the states, the entire country being a union of states. But very importantly, the words President and Governor, words that frequently occur in the Constitution, are euphemistic. They don't in fact mean the President acting on his own or the Governor acting on his own. They mean the Council of Ministers at the center with the Prime Minister at its head, acting in the name of the President, and the Council of Ministers in each state with the Chief Minister at its head, acting in the name of the Governor. The third part of the Union Judiciary, consists of the Supreme Court of India, the final interpreter of the Constitution and the laws, the final appellate authority from all decisions of high courts and tribunals. It is also the exclusive forum for deciding all federal disputes between the Union and the states. Under India's Constitution, the power to promulgate ordinances, which is a lawmaking power, has been designedly conferred additionally on the executive, only to be exercised when parliament or state legislatures are not in session, which is, as it turns out, for several months in each and every year. In England, where parliamentary system of government originated, the executive has no such power to legislate by ordinance except when a state of emergency is declared. The ordinance-making provisions in the Constitution establish at the very start a tilt in the balance of powers and functions in India's Constitution. They emphasize that it is the executive branch that is in the driving seat of government. And as if to stress the dominance of the executive, there is no period prescribed in India's constitution for the duration of each session of parliament or of state legislatures, which is left entirely to the governments, both at the center and in the states, as to when the houses of parliament and state legislatures are to be summoned and for how long. Thus, the constitution envisaged both at the center and in the states an all-powerful executive, with the prime minister and his council of ministers at the center, the chief minister and his council of ministers in the states. It is the executive that sets the agenda for all legislative business. When the elective bodies are not in session, it is the executive that is also empowered to make laws under the ordinance-making power. And it is the executive that takes all action pertaining to subjects within the legislative competence of the legislatures. Under India's constitution, the executive is dependent for its continuance on the confidence of the elected members of the legislature. That is, the Lok Sabha at the center and the state assemblies in the states. The executive remains omnipotent only as long as the Council of Ministers retain the confidence of the elected representative in the Lok Sabha at the center and in the legislative assemblies in the states. Once that confidence is lost, the government in office has to resign, fresh elections have to be called. And this is what is known as ministerial responsibility, a constitutional doctrine which is at the heart of the parliamentary system of government. Subject to ministerial responsibility to the elected bodies, the executive can do all that legislatures can do. This was an aspect that was highlighted within a few years of the constitution being promulgated. In 1955, it was held by India's Supreme Court that the Constitution of India, unlike other Westminster-type constitutions elsewhere, did not recognize the doctrine of separation of powers in its absolute rigidity. But howsoever powerful the executive may be, there is one important feature. The purse strings are controlled by the legislatures. That is parliament and state legislatures, and not by the executive. All revenues of government of India and other monies received by or on behalf of the government have to be credited to the consolidated fund of India. Likewise in the states, and no monies can be withdrawn from the consolidated fund of India or the consolidated fund of a state except under appropriation that is made by enacted law. Importantly, this cannot be done by the executive in exercise of its ordinance-making power. Expenses of governments can only be met by means of a bill introduced in the elected House of the People, in Parliament, as well as elected legislative assembly in the states. Such a bill has to provide for appropriation out of the consolidated fund of the Union or the consolidated fund of the state, and has to be passed by the people's elected representative. The constitutional authority that supervises all financial matters is the Controller and Auditor General of India, a personage who exercises a restraining influence on the all-powerful executive. The CAG, as he is called, is appointed by the President by warrant under his hand and seal. He can only be removed from his office in like manner and on like grounds as a judge of the Supreme Court, that is on a motion passed by a two-thirds majority of members present and voting in Parliament, not otherwise. In the Constituent Assembly, the Controller and Auditor General of India had been described by Dr. Ambedkar as the most important officer in the Constitution. He continues to be the most important officer in the Constitution. One of the most significant features of the Constitution is the area, extent, and nature of the jurisdiction of India's Supreme Court. It is all pervasive. Laws enacted by India's Parliament and by state legislatures and all executive action taken in the name of the President at the center, in the name of the governor in the states, are finally and authoritatively interpreted and corrected by courts. the high courts, and ultimately the Supreme Court. The law declared by the Supreme Court is binding on all courts and authorities in the country, though not on the Supreme Court itself, because larger benches of the Supreme Court can review and revisit its prior decision. It is the ultimate court of appeal in all civil and criminal cases. Its writ extends to the 2 million square miles of Indian territory and over its now 1.4 billion inhabitants. India was far more governable in 1950 when there were only 330 million people. There is virtually no area of legislative, executive, or administrative activity beyond the scrutiny of the highest court. But ever since 1950, in the process of adjudication of center-state disputes under Article 131, there has been the lurking fear of a balkanized and fragmented India. For this reason, there has been a centrist bias that has dominated judicial thinking as well as decision making, namely to uphold and preserve the union. Under the Constitution, courts are empowered to invalidate not only executive orders, but also laws that may violate any or more, one or more fundamental rights guaranteed in Part 3. Part 3 is India's Bill of Rights. But are they also empowered to adjudicate on the validity of constitutional amendments passed with requisite special majority and following the procedure prescribed in the article that authorizes amendments, Article 368? On that great question, the Constitution is silent. With one single political party almost consistently returned to power at each election since 1952, and often returned with an overwhelming majority, the judges had from time to time plumbed the depths of silence in one of the world's longest constitutions, looking for some limitation on the amending power. After a prolonged and tortuous quest, they found it, but by majority 7-6 in a bench of 13 judges, in a case decided only in April 1973, where, as one of the justices delivering judgment in that case had said, the largest bench sat for the longest time to decide issues of grave moment, not only to the future of this country, but to the future of democracy itself. The case was titled His Holiness Keshavananda Bharati versus State of Kerala. It is better known as Keshavananda or the Fundamental Rights case. And a great American judge had once said, the power to declare the law carries with it the power and within limits the duty to make law where none exists. In reading implied limitations in the amending power, the majority in the Supreme Court, 7-6, court had certainly made new law. It was criticized and severely criticized as an assertion of naked political power in the guise of judicial interpretation. Frankly, it was. By propounding the basic structure theory, the guardians of the Constitution had at one power bound become guardians over the Constitution. Constitutional adjudicators had assumed the role of constitutional governors. Quite a legitimate criticism. With one single political party, the Congress, having an overwhelming majority of members in Parliament, India would have moved into a state of grave constitutional crisis. But then fate intervened. At times, fate does help to preserve a constitution. In June 1975, Mrs. Indira Gandhi, then Prime Minister, lost an election petition filed against her in the Allahabad High Court. The High Court set aside her election as a member of Parliament. The extraordinary had happened. A serving Prime Minister had been unseated in Parliament. Whilst her appeal in the Supreme Court was pending, the Constitution 39th Amendment Act of 1975 was hastily drafted and even more hastily passed. The Constitution 39th Amendment provided that notwithstanding any order of any court, this is how it is worded, notwithstanding any order of any court the election of a prime minister can never be and would never be deemed to be invalid or void. The judgment of Justice Sinha of the Allahabad High Court unseating Mrs. Gandhi as Member of Parliament was attempted to be reversed by a constitutional amendment. But fortunately, India's highest court resisted this crude attempt, relying for the first time after the Keshavananda case on the basic structure theory of the constitution. In the case of Indira Gandhi versus Raj Narayan, a constitution bench of the Supreme Court held in 1975 under compulsions of what could only be characterized as a monstrous law that free and fair elections were a fundamental part of the constitution, so fundamental as to be beyond the reach of the amending power. This decision constitutes, in my view, the high watermark in the assertion of the court's judicial power in the presence of a very determined majoritarian regime. Because if the pernicious clauses of the 39th Amendment had been upheld, Indian democracy would not have long survived. The basic structure theory was the response of an anxious and activist court to the experience of the working of India's constitution during the nation's first 25 years. But fortunately, Parliament itself then endorsed and recognized the validity of the basic structure theory. By the Constitution 44th Amendment Act 1978, Parliament, acting then in its constituent capacity and not legislative capacity, declared that the fundamental right to life and liberty that had been guaranteed by Article 21 of the Constitution could never be suspended, even during a period of an emergency. This was because the right to life and liberty, safeguarded under Article 21, was basic to the constitutional framework. The basic structure theory is now an indissoluble part of the constituent framework. There is just one other aspect. The constitution had all provided and continues to provide that appointments of high court judges and judges of the Supreme Court are to be made by the President of India, which under our constitution means the President of India acting on the advice of the Prime Minister and his Council of Ministers, in practice on the advice of the Law Minister. In addition, the Constitution provided and continues to provide that appointments of judges to the Supreme Court and High Courts can only be made after consultation with the Chief Justice of India and such other judges of the Supreme Court or High Courts as the President, that is the government of the day, may determine. In the past, as a matter of convention, though not as a matter of constitutional compulsion, the advice of the Chief Justice of India had been invariably accepted by the government then in office. But in 1981, a bench of seven judges of the Supreme Court, by majority 4-3, narrow majority, in a case that came to be later known as the first judge's case, held that even after constitutional consultation, the final word in appointments would remain with the executive, that is with the government of India. This was so held on a textual reading of Article 217. But power grows by what it feeds on. No sooner had it been so held by the Constitution Bench of the Supreme Court in the first judge's case than the central government began to ignore the advice and recommendations of the Chief Justice of India as to selection of judges to be appointed to the higher judiciary, that is in the high courts and on the Supreme Court. The government of India then proceeded to appoint judges to high courts in a manner as though they were effectively on probation, their tenure being extended from 3 to 6 months at a time. Again, Article 222 of the Constitution enabled the government of India to transfer a judge from one high court to another, but after consultation with the Chief Justice of India. It had been settled practice that this could be done only for administrative exigencies. But after the majority decision of 1981, transfers of judges were effective for punitive reasons as well, where, for instance, a particular judge had rendered a decision unfavorable to the government of the day. these aberrations were now challenged once again before the Supreme Court of India. And fortunately, the challenges were all upheld by successive benches, larger benches of 9 judges. First in the year 1993, and then in the year 1998. The 1981 decision was overruled. The judges now said that a constitution was not to be interpreted literally. A purposive construction was to be preferred. All of which once again recalls the same old adage, suitably adapted, that power, wheresoever it resides, grows by what it feeds on. I come to the last, my conclusion. In India's constitution as enacted, though after considerable debate and also with much acrimony, it was decided that not just Hindi, spoken by more than 80% of the population, but both Hindi as well as English should be the national languages in India. Not in an attempt to anglicize the people of India, only to keep North and South together. In other words, to preserve the identity of one nation. Besides, India's entire legal system had been originally an English transplant with Anglo-Saxon roots. Introduced by the British in India, it had grown over the years, nourished in Indian soil. What was intended by the British to be a solid English oak over the years has now turned into a large banyan tree whose serial roots have descended to become new trunks. India's constitution, along with India's entire legal system, are now rooted in Indian soil. On the eve of the day that we now annually celebrate as Constitution Day, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, regarded as the father of the Constitution, expressed some very serious misgivings. This is what he said in India's Constituent Assembly on November 25th, 1949. We must begin by acknowledging the fact that there is a complete absence of two things in Indian society. One of them is equality. On the social plane, we have in India a society based on the principle of graded inequality, which means elevation for some, degradation for others. On the economic plane, we have a society in which there are some who have immense wealth, as against many who live in abject poverty. Dr. Ambedkar then went on to make a prediction. It has since proved to be prophetic. This is what he said. On the 26th of January, that is the next day, we are going to enter into a life of contradictions. In politics, we will have equality. In social and economic life, we will have inequality. And he then rhetorically asked, how long shall we continue to deny equality in our social and economic life? For the past 75 years, the troubling question still remains unanswered. Besides, a constitution is all about politics. And the real problem about politics in India, as in truly democratic countries of the world, is its unpredictability. James Reston, the doyen of 20th century American journalists, started his newspaper career as a sports writer. Some years before he died, he told the Washington Post that he always preferred sports to politics, because, as he said, at the end of the day, you know who has won. In politics, you have to wait 60 years to see how it all comes out. The 1.4 billion people of India have waited, not 60, but 75 years now, and it is still not clear how it will all come out. Only one thing is predictable, one thing is certain. India's constitution, as adopted in 1950, and amended from time to time, has survived. God willing and humans equally willing, it will continue. But only if we keep working in the way Dr. Ambedkar had prescribed. In other words, only if those who are called upon to work the Constitution continue to remain a good lot. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Nariman. That was an absolute tour de force, a magnificent overview of the Indian Constitution and of the last 75 years, really, of India's constitutional history. Absolutely wonderful. We covered a phenomenal amount of ground, and it was wonderful to have your perspective on it. And as you said, a constitution remains in force, and it survives as long as we who are called upon to work it continue to remain a good lot. So a lot of responsibility on the shoulders of us all. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you. Great.
Thank you, Mr. Nariman and Triple Daman, for an insightful session. Thank you all for watching and being a great audience. We encourage you to buy the books of our speakers that are available at the Boulder Bookstore. If you like this session, do consider supporting us through the Support JLF option button on the right-hand side of your screen. We sincerely value your contributions. Once again, we would like to thank you, all our official partners. We hope you all enjoyed these conversations and will tune back in for our next session. Art Matters. Anna Solarkis and Anubhav Nath in conversation with Sanjoy K. Roy at 3 p.m. Mountain Time, 2:30 a.m. Indian Standard Time, 4 p.m. Central Time, 2 p.m. Pacific Time, and 5 p.m. Eastern Time. Thank you once again, and now presenting a reading from the JLF Writer Short Series by Anchal Malhotra.
Hi everyone, my name is Anchal Malhotra. I am an oral historian and a writer, and I'm here to talk about my two upcoming books. So later in 2021, I have a book out titled In the Language of Remembering, which I suppose is the most natural sequel to my debut book, Remnants of a Separation. It is a series of conversations, mediations, thoughts, observations, interviews with subsequent generations of partition-affected families. So children, grandchildren, sometimes even great-grandchildren, to understand what they think of the event of partition and whether it affects them in any way. Partition, by all accounts, was a magnanimous event. It affected and changed the lives of millions of people. But I have wondered for many years whether the generation after eyewitness accounts, the generation of children or grandchildren, ever thinks about the event of partition and whether that memory gets transmitted and passed down the generations, and how that is, whether they perceive partition as an event of pain, as an event of trauma, as an event of fear, as something that makes them angry or bitter, whether they feel a sense of longing towards a land they have never seen, that their ancestors have come from. So I think that it is an interesting and very urgent collection of conversations, because the larger question it tries to ask is partition still relevant? Should we still be talking about it? And apart from the fact that it may still affect us politically and determine our relationships with our neighbors, does it affect us personally? And then in 2022, I have a novel out, and I have to admit, I'm a bit nervous talking about this, because fiction is something that I had never written before this. It is titled The Book of Everlasting Things, and it is a story that spans several generations of a family. It spans from the year 1830 all the way up to the 21st century, and it looks at how a family of perfumers from the walled city of Lahore were affected by World War I, World War II, partition, and post-partition emigration out of the Indian subcontinent. And I think, of course, it is a family of perfumers, so it is quite a sensorial book because it looks at the overlap of memory and senses, smell. But at its heart, it is also a love story because it revolves around these two children. When the book opens, there are these two children, Samir, who is a Hindu boy from the family of perfumers, and Firdaus, who is a Muslim girl, and she's a calligrapher. And they are torn apart by partition, and Samir becomes Indian and Firdaus becomes Pakistani. And I think in some ways I always return to the event of partition, how it has affected lives, and how Samir and Firdaus are torn apart and find their way back to one another through the medium of smell and perfumery. So these are the two books, In the Language of Remembering, out in 2021, and The Book of Everlasting Things, out in 2022.
Festival like this is a beautiful indication of the kind of thing that I truly, truly believe in, and I think makes our society more whole and more pure.
We do not take it for granted that Boulder was chosen as the first North American satellite festival. It's a huge honor we will not forget, and we are enriched because of it. We are indebted to both the local and international people that came together to make that happen, and we hope it's a tradition that continues for decades to come.
Literary festivals like this one build up an environment and an ecosystem to nurture readers and to promote the business of books. They provide an invaluable forum for writers to connect with other creative people.
We sit there peering into those electronic grids in front of our eyes, and it only increases the desire to see the real thing in the flesh. To actually hear an author speak firsthand, to read from their work, to hear the tones of their voice modulate as they read their most treasured passages of prose.
For us, it's special. This was our mothership, and it continues to be. The other editions that we have across the United States are smaller versions, different programming, but smaller versions.
In a sense, to me, religion and art are the same thing. They're vaguely irrational, but they help make sense of things. Someone who lives with no arts and no religion has very little to live on.
2019 was the 14th consecutive year of decline in global freedom.
You have to think of viruses as intelligent machines, as code crackers. And like all living forms, they have to adapt to their environment.
Imagination is a powerful tool. It doesn't matter which part of the world we are in our situation. Are we behind locked bars? Are we roaming freely, independent thought and process? Our imagination allows us to soar out of any present circumstances that we find ourselves in. And that really is the power of literature and the written word. It allows us to envision a better future. It allows us to consider our past and make sense of the present. Imagination is a tool to be able to free us from the binds and the constrictions that we find ourselves locked into. We can break free. We can soar through the universe. We can rise up into the darkened night like a firefly, illuminating the world. This is what JLF Boulder, Colorado hopes to bring you, something to fire your imagination.